Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome
God
and
Monster! Hi, everybody. Welcome to the show. We're just going to go ahead and get started. We got four people here today. Well, counting you and me, it's four people.
Yep.
I made it sound like a lot of people were here, but there's always two here.
Four and a half.
My name's Art Miles. This is Greg Moan. We have our friends Beth and Bill here. We're going to go around the table real quick. We'll start with Bill over there. Bill, what are you drinking this evening?
Tonight I am drinking on recommendation a Hell or High Watermelon. This is a wheat beer. It's very light, very crisp. I like it.
I haven't tried any of the canned beers yet. I've always gone for the bottles. Beth, what about you? What are you drinking this evening?
Oh, this is embarrassing because I'm actually a beer drinker, but they have this really delicious black cherry hard cider here, Mackenzie's. So
Mackenzie's,
I'm
yes.
drinking cider.
Oh, my
Greg?
God. Iron Man
hey,
is here.
Hey, check it out.
Holy cow. Once wow. again, camera's failing us, not yeah. seeing what's going on the outside of the store.
Well, it's probably a copyrighted image right. anyway. We get screwed.
Yeah. The little thing's glowing anyway. Okay, two beers. Greg, what do you got?
I am drinking, I'm already kind of fuzzy. All I right. am drinking something called St. Bernardos ABT 12.
Watch it with the big words. Okay.
I don't know. It's all a 10% beer.
Oh, that's right.
To wash that down, I got
carbonated scotch.
It's delicious. It's actually very, very good. I also
really
have
good.
Here, oh my God, we're spiking
we're
all over the place.
All over. It sounds
I'm
good in the ears.
Sorry. Well, oh. it's two different leads. I'm also drinking a banana bread beer from Wells, and it's very delicious.
Oh,
it's,
you're drinking both at the same time? A little mixing it up.
Two-fisted.
He drinks one and spits it out, just to keep the palate clean.
I can't, whatever Sarah tells me to drink, I drink.
All right, very good. I'm also drinking, once again, the Cider Boys First Press hard cider I love. I think I've started getting it here every week now. And then I got the Todd Fisher favorite,
back,
of
back
course.
To Old Faithful.
The Orange Dream. It's just a soda, and it's Todd's favorite, and I always get that here. It's good at the end of the night. All so right. We'll do a little bit of business here real quick. Coming up on September 30th here at Gods and Monsters, Wrestling Returns. Now, we always like to try and do a show.
Big elbow.
They will probably let us, as they did previously, let us record the pre-shows.
The undercard matches.
Yes, the undercard matches. They let us record, and then they flip on their cameras because they do a live streaming service, which is a paid service. So for me to turn cameras on and give it to them for free, not a good idea. So they'll let us do like we did before, and this will be WWNLive.com. You can go to their website, and you can order the wrestling matches,
it
which
is
go
crazy
on.
Fun. I suggest you go.
It's pretty cool to be here. I don't even know what they charge. $15 general admission. Front row, $25 for front row, because you never know when that folding chair is coming your way.
You might get wet.
You might get wet or have spit fly past you, splash as zone. Happened to us. But that's coming up on September 30th. It's a Friday night, so we'll be doing a show from there from that night. If everybody wants to come on down
yeah.
or watch, we will be on YouTube. And thank you again for watching and subscribing. Okay, other business we want to take care of. Last time we did a show here, we went out after the birthday show that we did and saw Sausage Party. Sausage Party.
So that was a
wow.
movie.
Wow.
Yeah,
that
I was about to ask.
Did you see it?
No.
Okay.
I've seen the previews, and I'm sort of like, I don't know that I need to see this in theaters, per se.
It was a little surprising because the preview or the attraction, what is it called? The
Trailer.
I'm sorry. Thank you. The trailer didn't exactly explain what the movie was. It seemed like in the trailer it was all about, you know, food, thinking they were gonna, you know, have this great life outside of the grocery store, and then they get home,
right.
And then they realize, oh my God, we're food. And I thought that was gonna be the movie.
Right.
That's not the movie.
There was more to it than that. Maybe they didn't want to reveal it in the trailer.
I guess not. And from that perspective, it worked very well. But I was expecting some adventure movie of getting out of the house before they were eaten.
Right.
But that was not
that was
the
not
movie.
It at all. Yeah. And I would love to sit down and interview young couples going out on their first dates who go see this movie.
Well, from what I've heard, they've had an issue trying to keep children away from seeing this movie.
It's animated about food.
Right,
let's
exactly.
go. It's
yeah.
like rated, the Religitables.
Yeah. It's rated R, you
yes.
idiots.
Yeah. I know.
Yeah, there was a case where the trailer actually got stuck in the middle of family.
Nemo or something like that? Yes, I did hear that too. Yeah. Oh, I'd love to explain that to kids, what they saw.
Well, then let's just take 90 seconds here and talk about what
Please.
Is the most awkward first date you've ever had. Like, when you go, 'cause sometimes you go to a movie as your first date. Have you ever been to an awkward first date movie?
I don't think so. No, I don't have an experience like
Borat.
That. Oh, you did?
Yep.
Borat from 1990, awkward. 2000, what was that around?
Who knows, but
All
it
right.
was...
It was, yeah, that's if that's a first date, wow, that's exactly
that
what I was describing. That's an awkward
Beth, any,
first
any
date.
Awkward
first
it's
date movie?
It was not a movie, no. I've had awkward first dates.
And it was?
A movie. At a restaurant. Woohoo. No, it was just, I don't.
Was it Chuck E. Cheese?
No. It was actually at a brewery. I can't remember how I met the guy, but
Chuck
it was
e.
like,
Cheese.
He seemed cool enough. And then once we got there, I was sort of like, so what do you like to do? And he's like, I like to go to church. And I'm like,
wow.
Oh, cool.
And the record scratch.
Yeah. That was
oh,
about
I'm,
the end
I'm
of
getting
it.
A text. I got to go.
Wait, yeah. Texting hasn't come out yet.
What? I actually got hit on by the server because I had these shoes that laced all the way up to the knee. And he was
that
like,
sense.
He was like, your shoes are amazing. And I was like, oh, thank you. And he's like, well, a couple might do on more, but you're on a date.
So oh,
at
wow.
the end of the night, I left my phone number with the bill, but he never called.
Oh, so. What a maybe jerk. He thought you just left him a 7-digit tip.
Maybe.
Better check your account.
Yeah.
Holy cats, $87,000.
Oh, goodness. One of the other things we like to do here is bring a few things to the table, and why not celebrate Star Trek's 50th anniversary by just showing a few things
pew,
here
pew,
that you
pew.
Can buy at Gods and Monsters. How much is the bank?
That's
it's upside
the noise
down there.
It makes.
This is $200.
Oh, no, it's plastic. I made sure of it.
$23.
$23. And the Risk game, $50. Does that say 50
oh, this
on
is
there?
A bank?
Price tag? In the upper right-hand corner?
Kerplunk. Let's see.
It is Risk.
Yes, that is... $50.
Yeah, $50 for the game of Risk, which has all the captains.
I haven't played Risk since college, and
yeah,
I would love to
that
again.
Was,
oh, they have a Risk for everything.
I'm glad you said
Star
that.
Wars
do they,
Risk,
do they,
Star Trek Risk.
Do they have a Firefly Risk?
They must, right?
You know,
they
probably.
I'm sure.
Access and
it's
Allies
like Monopoly
or something.
Was in the 90s. There was a Monopoly
no,
for everything.
No, there's still
everything.
A Monopoly for everything.
That's
there
true.
Is. There is. And it's stupid because it's a terrible game.
And if I had...
that lasts like 5 hours.
Yeah, there's Star Wars Monopoly. There's Simpsons Monopoly. There's Star Trek Monopoly. All the Monopolies are out there.
I have a Star Wars Monopoly that I have opened exactly once to examine the miniatures.
Yeah. Hmm. I had Star Wars Monopoly, and I also bought Star Wars Monopoly DVD-ROM.
Wait,
so.
Didn't you also... You also have
actually,
Simpsons Monopoly.
Yeah. Yeah, which is actually, we put that in the game section here. Gotcha. We left Simpsons Monopoly and Star Wars Monopoly back here and
very
Simpsons
cool.
or Star Wars trivia back here. One other Star Trek thing, you know, 50th anniversary of Star Trek. Did you watch Star Trek?
Not the original series, but
Next
Generation.
Fine. That's
yes.
fine.
Well,
we all have, I mean, I'm sure we could pick some of our favorite moments of episodes
shut
from Star
up,
Trek.
Wesley.
But what I was thinking, what was your greatest Star Trek experience? And I think I have one. Maybe it's similar to yours or not. I'll do mine first, and you can think about it. When we were living at the fraternity house together, this was 92, 93, the Borg episode came out, the two-part Borg
oh,
episode. And
sure.
just
so
the
good.
Ending of part one was so damn good, and we were
wait,
all in the room
this?
Together, and it was Mr. Worf, fire.
Yep.
And you know, and then it goes to the credits, and everybody
yep.
in the room was just like, ah! But it was such a great moment, because Star Trek Next Generation was at its absolute peak at that,
that
point.
That was the longest summer
yes.
ever.
Oh, good.
Waiting for the conclusion of that.
Now, there are other, I'm sure, great moments. You don't have to pick like your favorite scene from your favorite episode, but do you have any great moments like that? We were all together as a group watching the final episode of the season. They had teased it all week that the Borg were coming, and that was just a great moment.
Probably my favorite moment was when I had to, as social chair, come up to the bedroom and tell all you knuckleheads to go downstairs because there was a house full of women that we were supposed to be having a party with.
Is that the same
and
day?
You dorks were watching Star Trek.
And you still got nominated president somehow.
I don't know how that happened.
Wow, that happened the same night? I really don't remember that.
I
don't even
remember. I was the lesser of two evils. Hillary Clinton.
What night of the week was Star Trek Next Generation on? I don't even remember.
I don't either.
I remember Saturdays.
Saturday
evenings? Yeah, I remember Saturdays.
That
well,
makes
poor planning.
I know it was the same. It was often at the same time as baseball. And living in Cleveland,
baseball
would go
every day.
Okay, but
yeah.
Maybe it was Saturday then.
Hmm.
All right. Can you have any think of any
wait,
moment,
you were living
any
in Cleveland?
Great Star Trek moment that was a part of your life?
Oh,
God,
oh absolutely. I can think of a couple. First of all, when I was about six or seven, watching the original series,
sure.
It's my favorite, was the Doomsday Machine, the episode The Doomsday Machine. The Planet Killer.
Yes.
That scared the hell out of me when I was 7.
Because when you're a kid, you believe that could be real. Yes.
Oh, yeah. And they're playing, you know, Jaws had just come out.
Yes.
And then there's a very
well,
similar musical
scary
cue. you know, dun dun
sure.
dun. And you know, you got poor the Commodore in his wrecked ship talking about, you know, this thing is the devil out of hell,
right.
you know. And I would say to kind of fast forward a few years, of course, Spock's death.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
You know, oh,
in the theater.
God, just
in the theater, yes.
The end of two, right?
Now,
yeah.
The first movie came out in 78, so I was only 7. I didn't see the first one in the theater, but I saw the second one. And I just remember the theater.
Yeah.
Afterward.
Not a dry eye.
No, just very sad. Very, very sad. Do you have a Star Trek memory that you can think of?
I met Brent Spiner, who, as you know,
whoa!
Plays Data and
that
Lore
is cool.
and Dr. Noonien's song.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Dr. Noonien
and he
Center?
Hit on me, yes. So it was really
yes. Oh, I didn't know that was in his
yeah,
programming.
No,
he put his emotion chip in that day.
You timed that.
I have heard that Brent Spiner is a colossal dick.
Oh no.
Well, he was very nice to me, but yes, I've heard that as well.
Yeah. Oh no, I don't want to hear that.
Well,
no,
here's what
I
you
know.
Need to do, Art. You need to go on Netflix. There is a very cool documentary playing on Netflix right now about Star Trek Next Generation.
Okay.
About how that show even became a thing, how Gene Roddenberry was in the throes of alcoholism and drug abuse.
At the
and
time,
they,
wow.
they kind of had to wheel him into productions, and he thought he was in control, and they had to pretend that he was in control.
Wow.
It was
Who made this documentary?
I don't recall, but it's definitely worth watching. It's a mess. How that show actually happened.
Wow, that's very fascinating.
Was that the one where it was about they changed it from a plot-centered episode to a character-centered episode?
Yes.
Okay, yes, I did see that one. It is actually really good.
Why? Hold on. I got it.
He's got the remote.
But aside from Brent Spiner, I did watch it growing up, and I just put a picture on Facebook about how that was my first cosplay, quote-unquote. It was about 1991.
Yes?
Myself and my brother and the two neighbor kids down the street all dressed up as Next Generation people.
Oh, really?
And it like, was
that's cool. Were they homemade costumes or store-made?
Oh, of course.
Did I do something wrong by flipping the monitor?
They didn't have store-made costumes back then.
No. Wow, that's kind of cool. We're just checking one of our cameras here real quick. For some reason, it stopped recording. Was it ever recording?
Yeah, it was.
How about the camera flash? I'll just do that real quick just to make sure.
Sure.
Just to make sure. We'll try and get... Cha-ching.
Sorry.
That's okay. Camera flash is back on.
All right.
So store-bought costumes, you said, or homemade?
No, homemade.
Homemade
they
costumes.
I don't think they had Spirit Halloween and all that back then. If they do, I don't remember them.
Were any of the kids dressed up as a Klingon?
No.
Because those are challenging costumes.
But we
yes.
did have a friend who
Today
was Geordi.
Today is a good day for candy.
So I guess he was technically white-facing Geordi.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
No.
But of course we had this official communicators, but before the internet you had to like find out through word of mouth where to buy these things.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And there was only one place to get them, and it was like an hour away across Cleveland to try and find these communicators.
Cleveland.
I know, right?
You know, it's interesting how the internet has really opened up so much for so many.
Yeah.
And I come back to my stupid car channel where I couldn't do any of the stuff that I do if I didn't have the internet and YouTube, just because
learning how to
wouldn't know anything.
How to
and
disassemble something.
Just ordering little tiny parts that you might need, just finding them is impossible. But now with the internet, everything is cataloged, everything is a picture, everything
right.
is a delivery in 2 days. It's just like, it's so awesome.
Many was a Saturday when something on one of the rattling heaps that passed as cars in my family. The whole Saturday was, you know,
working on the car.
We're going to junkyards,
yeah.
plural, looking for part singular.
And working on it was hitting it with a wrench until it turned over.
Yeah, essentially.
Well, one of the reasons, yeah, of course,
1970s rural Alabama.
No, let's go on to
you
the
want a box office predictions?
Box office predictions.
Okay, now the last time we did this, we didn't do predictions, did we? Or like, did we?
We did. We
we tried to guess on.
Crap, what did we do?
Well, we talked about Ben-Hur, which I thought we talked about. It only made $11 million its first weekend, and we were all way off on that.
And it's made about $12 million total.
Yes.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Were we going to try and make
abysmal.
Sausage Party predictions?
Yeah, we did. Yeah. And
I don't remember the numbers, so.
I don't either.
I mean, it wasn't. Okay.
Anyway, let's
talk
about
for this
Sully.
Week coming up. What's coming up this week, Greg?
Sully is the only movie that I recognized and had seen a trailer for.
Directed by Clint Eastwood. Tom Hanks, I believe, was on Jimmy Kimmel last night with Sully, the actual Sully.
By the way, have you seen that meme where it's like, I am never traveling with Tom Hanks ever?
I mean, the reasons.
The plane crashes.
And Apollo 13.
Apollo 13, the Mayor Scalabama.
Castaway.
Yep.
Castaway. Yeah, and now right. this.
So let's do some predictions on what opening weekend domestic will be for Sully.
Not a lot of movies coming out right now. I mean, the big sci-fi summer movies have kind of made their money, mm-hmm. so I think the summer has started to come to an end, but it's Clint Eastwood, it's Tom Hanks, it's a story that's still fresh in people's mind. I'm going to say it's going to make $23 million in its first weekend.
Hmm. That's very close to where I was going to be, but I'll reserve my prediction until the end. Bill?
I'm thinking 27. I think people are oversaturated with you know, big spectacle movies
True.
Right now. People want to relax. People want to see something grown up. So I'm thinking 27.
All right.
Same neighborhood as Art, a little bit more.
Sure.
Okay. Beth?
I'm going to pass.
Oh, pass. You could have thrown a number out.
Sorry. I know. Wait, hold on. 22.
There you go.
Undercut.
Bracketing there. I believe that there is nothing else to see this weekend because that's the only movie that I could recognize. Not too many people are seeing Suicide Squad again.
No.
And not too many people are going to see
Sausage Party.
Well, that's done. I mean, that's pretty much done. I believe it's going to do 30.
Oh, okay. The highest number so far. Yeah. 30, 27, 23, and 22, which might be the winner.
Bill was 28.
We try and do box off predictions.
No.
If you're
I'm sorry.
If you're watching on YouTube, put down your number, type it up in the comment section. Let us know. If you win, we'll say your name or something. Or you'll
we'll
win this risk game. No, I can't do that. I can't do that. I can't
win
back
this
that up.
Empty bottle.
I can't back that up. All right, so that is our box office predictions. Yep. But the main reason we're here, and the title of the episode probably at the above of YouTube, is that it's another episode with Bill Silvey, Dungeons & Dragons Antique Roadshow. Yes.
Hey.
Now, Bill, you just go ahead and start with whatever item you want to start with first. We've got I got a camera right here with a countdown. We still have 45 minutes until the cameras run dead. So you start with what
Holy
you want
shit,
to start
we're
with.
Staying on time and everything.
I know we got to keep it moving because I don't want to
red, but I think we're good to go.
I don't want to cut short on what Bill has, and Stranger Things is in everybody's minds right now, and some things kind of came up.
That was supposed to be a secret.
Yeah, Stranger Things has kind of been mentioning. You know, it's kind of buzzing around 80s and Stranger Things and Dungeons and Dragons, and Bill had some things maybe to comment in that regard and show us some things.
Okay,
what you got?
All right, well, first of all, we have some viewer feedback from the first episode.
What?
Yes.
From the original Antiques Roadshow.
From the original D&D Antiques Roadshow.
Oh,
yeah,
very good.
So this is actually, full disclosure, this is from my buddy Paul.
All right.
Who tuned in and watched. And he just had some minor points.
If you recall, Bill brought on the first episode some of the original paper books.
The original D&D set.
Yeah, you had some signed things. You had some personal notes from the
creators.
Just
to refresh the memories of the people. Yes.
Now, Paul wanted just kind of a heads up that it was Greg Bell was the cover artist for the original.
All right.
The original D&D books.
Greg Bell. Did we misspeak in some way?
I did.
Oh, I did.
I didn't have my notes together.
Some corrections.
And it was the company that was putting out Chainmail. The first print of Chainmail, which was D&D's progenitor, of course, was Gaidon was the name of the company.
Gaidon. Okay.
Yes. Yes. So just a couple little notes from him.
Good. We appreciate you keeping us current and updated, and if there's any corrections, to do that.
Thank you, Paul. So with that said,
go ahead.
Let's jump right
into
the...
You go into your first item. I'm going to scroll through and remind audiences what episode number that was you first came in case they want to scroll back.
Thank you.
Because we are at 120 episodes now.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. And
we need to let people know. Yeah.
There's going to be like a little annotation right over here
that
you're going to click on. You're not going
to
do it?
What do you want me to do? Click on what now? I'm not doing that.
Never mind.
I'm not doing it.
You're not a YouTuber.
Go ahead, Bill. You go ahead while I try and find your episode.
And you know this is good because it's yellowed.
Because it's yellowed.
Weathered.
Yes. It's time.
It was used and it was loved. Yes.
Okay. So,
and remember, you show that right to your camera whenever you have something you want to show us.
There's mysterious stains on the back as
yes.
well.
Oh, no.
Yes.
Yeah.
So last episode when we did Roadshow, we had the original three Dungeons & Dragons books, Chainmail, and the first, in modern terms, you'd call it a splat book, the first addendum for original Dungeons & Dragons, which was called Greyhawk, Supplement 1 Greyhawk. Well, they didn't rest on their laurels, and they released this bad boy right here. This is called Blackmore. This is Supplement 2. And like Greyhawk before it, this introduces new classes, new races, new monsters. And we've got some great art in here, actually, not art, but and we had to... This was written by Dave Arneson.
Anytime, you want to flip, and you can put that you can stretch it out if you want because the GoPro
you can right
get
up
as close
there.
As you want. Right. Yes, love it.
There we go.
It's good, right?
And that is Dave Arneson's signature there.
Okay.
This particular book, and I have this is no one of consequence. that is how it was received. Someone's initials in it there.
Okay.
But this particular book was actually slated to be the first supplement for Dungeons & Dragons.
Supplement, okay.
Supplement, right. That is what they were calling them back then, rules supplement, and all right there.
By the way, Bill Silvey was here for episode 44, doing a little history with us, and then he was here for episode 93.
That was way back.
93
was 44 was with your Gary Gygax history, and then episode 93 was when Bill first came here with the Antiques Roadshow. Please continue.
Right. No, that's okay. But anyway, so Blackmoor is important for a few different reasons. It is, again, it's the second supplement that Dungeons & Dragons released. There's new monsters, new spells, new rules, new classes. But this particular book contains something that no other publication from TSR or third parties had. This contains the first pre-published Dungeons & Dragons adventure.
Okay.
It's called Temple of the Frog.
Sounds very exciting.
Yes, as the
would this be the equivalent of quests that would be from modern day RPGs on computers?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. This is. I think we were kind of tossing around. This is the second DLC.
So for all you snotty kids who only play RPGs, this is where this all started.
This is where this all started. Know your history, damn it. Do you have a copyright on that, by the way? Copyright date?
This was 75,
nice.
I believe.
Wow.
Yeah, 1975.
Beth, what were you doing in 75?
I was negative 13 years old.
Never mind.
Negative 10, bless your heart.
So there's a lot of... a lot of interesting odds and ends in this particular book. Some of the rules were kind of translated forward. Some of them lived and died in this book. They didn't go any further. But this was kind of the next step along for Dungeons & Dragons and its evolution. Dave Arneson was one of the founding members of TSR, one of the co-creators of Dungeons & Dragons. And Gary wanted to get his...
While you're talking, go ahead and just hold the cover up for a few seconds.
Sure. Gary wanted to get, wanted to kind of capture that light, you know, bottled lightning or lightning in a jar, as a phrase goes.
Maybe this is an ignorant question. I don't really know. But so when new rule sets come out and such, mm-hmm. Obviously... maybe people decide that things work or don't work or whatever. Can you give me an example of something that was written in that was, like you said, died in that expansion book?
Sure. Now, Dungeons & Dragons was a very abstract gaming system. And it's become the lexicon of whether you game on PC, console, tabletop, whatever, of hit points. You hit somebody, you do 1 point of damage, and their life ebbs out 1 point.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
There's not a very specific, I stab him in the eye, I stomp on his foot. There are game systems that do that.
Well, that's the game master's job, is really to explain where the hit happens and stuff like that, yeah.
Well, what Blackmoor attempted to do, and it's extremely fine print. These are very small tables, but I'm going to try and show them.
It looks like one of my cheat sheets from college.
Cliff Notes?
Yeah, right there.
Okay.
You can see that there is a table which attempts to codify precisely exactly where a person is hit and how much, what percentage of their hit points are located in that location.
Oh,
so if you have 10 hit points and I stab you in the hand, it might do 1 point of damage because I only stabbed you in the hand. It's an incredibly detailed system. It is not incredibly fast-paced.
As I understand, the more modern concept is... you roll your 20, and then based on that roll, it's either a hit or a miss.
Exactly.
And if you hit, then you roll a 6, or you roll a 4,
you roll a
6,
or an 8, or 4, just depending on weapon. You might add or subtract depending on the quality of the weapon. Is it magic? Is it cursed?
Well, moderators and stuff, yeah.
Right. But Blackmoor...
I'm actually learning from doing this other thing.
That's why we're here. We're here to learn.
We'll get you in a game someday, Greg.
I got it.
It'll happen. No, it'll happen.
This is actually really interesting because most games that I've played, it's the general hit a person, you do X damage. The only games I can think of, there's certain games like Fallout where you hit a particular area and it does more damage. The VAT system.
Exactly,
yes.
Yeah, so this is a lot like the VAT system for tabletop 40 years before, Fallout.
Which I had no idea about.
Think Fallout invented this?
No, I didn't say that. But the
location hit system, again, it adds a granularity. Bob the Fighter in a bog standard D&D game, let's say he starts out at 10 hit points and then, you know, mows down some orcs and some kobolds and some other bad guys and winds up with only one hit point. Mm-hmm. Well, there's no delineation of, okay, Bob's missing three fingers on his right hand.
That's a good point.
He's bleeding out and he's going to have his nose sewn back on. Blackmore attempted to address this with a hit location, hit percentage in that given location system, which isn't terrible, but when you stop to consider about the various fantastical monsters in Dungeons & Dragons, you know, okay, so you take a dragon, 2 to 4 legs, long,
right,
skinny
long
neck, head about the size of a dining room table, is about 20 feet away from its body, you know, it's got wings. It also attempts to deal with that.
Wow.
So now you take the heroic scenario where you've got a room full of bad guys who are person-shaped, and you've got a dragon, and the bad guys have got a druid who summons some giant insects, and suddenly you're stopping and rolling percentages and consulting that table in there every...
I can imagine that would slow down,
slow down the gameplay quite a bit.
So it's a degree of granularity that you can either embrace and say, this makes our game...
Calm down, Art.
I'm sorry. I just this don't make, normally... You know, I mean... Go, please. Yeah.
This makes our game, you know, this really makes our game hum, and it feels like a swashbuckler movie, or it can just be, as they say, 30 minutes of fun crammed into 4 hours.
So here's my question. Sorry, guys, I'm actually
super
nerd.
Do it.
So what I've always wondered is, it's like, all right, you have a dragon.
Right.
You're just like, I'm going to attack him. Attack. If you just saw his legs off, then he's just a stump dragon, and you win. Does it
stump
deal with
dragon,
stuff like
I
that?
I like that. I'm going to stat up a stump dragon tonight.
Does it deal with stuff like that? Like, all right, you cut off his wings, you cut off his legs, winning.
Yeah, that's what the granulated hit location system attempts to deal with. Whereas just vanilla D&D or D&D with just supplement one, Greyhawk just says, okay, you hack off 30 of the dragon's 40 hit points, and at this point he's backing into the corner with his tail between his legs, begging,
right,
you know, just take the treasure, just leave me alone. And I think Greg hit on it, you know, it's really the nuance is up to the dungeon master at that point to say, you know, okay, you know, one of his eyes is out, one of his wings is barely hanging on, he's dragging an almost severed foot behind him, or to just say, you stabbed him a lot. He's got some arrows stuck in him, he's burned from your lightning bolt. What do you do next, Greg? You know, that sort of thing.
So before
I'm
we move
I'm the
on
worst dungeon master ever.
Before we move on to the next item, would you consider this one of your rare items that you've collected you don't see a lot of?
Yes. Now, you can find, in various condition, you can find Blackmore. Since Dave passed away a few years ago, a year after Gary did, you're going to pay about $40 to $50 for a copy of
That seems low.
Two.
That
it
seems
does.
Low.
Agreed.
Generally, the single booklets by themselves don't command a huge amount of money.
Hmm.
You know, when you account for inflation... And you think about, you know, you buy a role-playing game today, and then you go out and you buy a supplement for it. Yeah, it, you know, that book costs about $30 or $40. So this is, you know, it's still right in line. Now, this particular one, and I don't like to brag, you know, with Dave Arneson's autograph.
All right, it adds to it. Yes, it definitely adds to it.
Yeah, that definitely adds to it. If you find something and you can establish provenance on it, of course, it's going to go up many, 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 many factors.
As it should.
This copy is, as pointed out, this is fairly beaten up. It looks like it was wedged between a Chilton's manual and
that's what makes
and a
it
can
awesome,
of oil.
Right. It's you. That's
it
played.
Was used. It
that
was loved.
Yes,
that well, was an actual played with manual
is,
game.
Yeah, that is the thing that I like to emphasize. You know, whomever, if you're out there watching this on the internet, JRJF, I salute you because. You clearly loved this book.
I don't want to shortchange any of your other items because you brought a whole box.
We
would you like
on.
To move on to the next?
We
gotta
move on.
Whatever
yes.
you got next.
Yes.
Thank
okay.
you for item
so
number one.
We're at 30.
Item number two.
This is a visual trick.
At the 30
oh.
This is a thing.
Oh, yes,
if
yes,
you've
yes.
Watched, if you've watched Stranger Things, and
yes.
I hope you have, you might be familiar
yes, Beth,
with
Stranger Things. Yes,
this
yes,
very
good.
You right here.
Yeah.
The Grenadier miniatures and the dungeon board game.
Right.
And this kind of dovetails together with talking about Stranger Things. When people started saying, "Bill, you got to see Stranger Things," or if you haven't, you know, have you seen Stranger Things? If you haven't, go watch it. I said, okay, well, you know, what's the deal? Because I'm seeing all these Dungeons & Dragons memes related to Stranger Things pop up on Facebook and just everywhere I turned. And so everyone said, no, watch, right. Trust. Okay. So this could get a little spoiler heavy. Is that okay with you guys?
I think at this point...
If you haven't seen it by now...
Yeah, you're watching the wrong podcast.
Yeah. So, you know...
And it paid off in the first 5 minutes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Thank you for stealing my thunder.
Sorry.
I'm just kidding. It did pay off in the first few minutes. The kids are playing Dungeons & Dragons.
Yep.
Right then, right there. And they're throwing dice. The interesting thing that I found was that they didn't, and this was with every aspect of the show, they could have gone crazy with and oversaturated us with, you know, here are their character sheets. Here's an exact D20. You know, we're going to carefully lay the D&D books out on the table so you can go Monster Manual, Dungeon Master's Guide, Player's Handbook. They didn't do that.
It was set dressing, which was the way to do it.
Exactly. And it's like the music. You know, you didn't hear an 80s pop tune every 5 minutes.
Right.
Boy, I sure do enjoy Tears for Fears.
Right.
Yes, but my favorite band is Men at Work. And, you know, then we segue into Down Under. They didn't make you drink from a pop culture fire hose, and that was so refreshing.
Mm-hmm.
Who was it? The Dust Brothers? Not the Dust Brothers.
Duffer Brothers.
The Duffer. Yes.
Although I did make that mistake, too. I think Stranger Things done by the Dust Brothers would be absolutely
awesome. That'd be awesome as well.
Yes, it would be equally awesome.
Like Tron in the 80s? I don't know.
Yeah, so there is a scene, of course, and I'm sure you guys all know, where the Department of Energy guys... are cleaning out the house.
Yes, down the basement.
You know, they're looking for L, and they're taking everything that L may have touched or been near, and they haul a box out of the basement with a copy of Dungeon and three yellow miniatures boxes in it. Now, unfortunately, I wanted to bring a Demogorgon miniature.
Is that an actual thing?
That is an actual miniature Grenadier. Created a Demogorgon miniature. Demogorgon's a major demon in AD&D and original D&D.
Was it a rare item?
No. Since Strange Things came out, though, that like you could buy a box. I mean, just like a cardboard box, just dumped full of miniatures from the 1970s,
right.
And find like two or three Demogorgons in various condition, and they're for like $20 on eBay. I'm talking miniatures that are in such a condition they'd be good for fishing lures, and that's about it.
Now a Demon Gorgon is going for $100.
Higher.
Really? Wow,
higher.
Really?
Well, the guy who sculpted the Demon Gorgon mini for Grenadier back in the day still has the mold, so he's going to be casting and selling more. So keep an eye out for that.
God,
from
that
the original mold.
Yeah.
No, right
oh,
now,
my God. That's amazing.
Yeah. Stranger Things brings you from the original mold.
Don't rush out and get consumed by nostalgia and be, oh, I've got to have a Demogorgon miniature.
Right.
I'll buy one for $200, because in a few months you'll probably be able to pick one up for $20.
How weird are we as people that when, you know, this stuff that is worthless, all of a sudden it's in something popular and you're just like, I have to have it.
Put such a high value
on it.
I
will pay a ridiculous amount of money for it.
It pushes down on your pop culture limbic system, and you're like,
something about nostalgia.
My childhood,
nostalgia has
must.
No price to it. And it's like, whatever it costs.
So
go ahead and bring that that dungeon box out.
Whatever it costs.
We're going to bring out Dungeon first. Okay. So this...
Is that still in the wrapper?
Looks like it.
No, it's not. The corners are taped.
Oh, the corners are taped. Yes, that's a very 70s thing. Tape the corners.
This particular game, this actually has more screen time than any other D&D product in the entire show of Stranger Things. This is a board game, obviously, that is it's a little bit Dungeons & Dragons-y, but not. Because what you do in Dungeon is everybody plays a separate... pawn in the game, and you run around the titular dungeon grabbing treasures out of rooms and fighting monsters on your own. But it's like Monopoly in that you're trying to get to a set monetary goal first and then get out of the dungeon.
Is it a
there is no let's team up and fight things together. It literally sets people against each other.
Would you say that's more accessible than Dungeons & Dragons to the layperson, to the average person?
Yeah, absolutely. And the neat thing is... Wizards of the Coast, of course, you know, they own everything that TSR produced. They bought TSR out in 99. They still publish Dungeon.
Wow.
It's in a slightly different format. It's a slightly smaller box than this, but if you want to get a fairly old school fun tabletop game that has some RPG-ish elements in it, but it's something you can knock down in 45 minutes or an hour. You can still pick up Dungeon today.
I think that's probably the most the biggest hurdle for people to start Dungeons & Dragons is that these campaigns take 40, 60, 80 hours.
It's complete.
And sometimes
investment.
People just want to sit down and play a game for a couple of hours.
And you know what? You hit on a very, very good thing, Greg. There are times like, you know, if 3 of 8 people don't show up for game night,
bring out the board game instead.
And we'll do some dungeon tonight.
Now, did you purchase this yourself as a child? Was this purchased for you? What's the history
this,
on
this? This particular box, I did not own Dungeon when I was a kid. I had friends that did.
I had a friend who did also.
I played it and I loved it. So when I got the chance to buy one before Wizards of the Coast started printing and selling it again, you know, I jumped on the chance. I picked this one up. I got this in a bundle of D&D stuff. You know,
Somebody's mom was selling stuff.
Exactly. And this
you want to refresh our memories with the board game?
Brian left for college. I don't know what to do with all this crap.
He never played with this.
That whole box, $5.
Right. But yeah, I thought this was fun. This is someone's house rules.
Oh,
tight
really?
House rules from God knows when.
Is that because they didn't have the original rules in the box anymore and maybe they bought
it? Sometimes you just make up your own rules. Right. Have you ever had house Monopoly rules?
Yes.
Yeah, of course.
Money and free parking. Yes, things like that.
So this offers some interesting variations.
Wow, house rules.
And like JRJF of Blackmore, I salute you, whoever typed these house rules up, because these are awesome.
That's awesome.
Are there any super vintage house rules in there?
Just these.
Like anything that say, like, you know, if someone calls and your mom picks up, you lose 10 points.
Oh,
like,
no. That, you know what?
That's good.
But I'm going to include that now.
That's good.
If you get a text. Right. If you get a text from your wife you'll lose 1,000 gold
pieces.
Right.
Oh, that's good. Everyone's phones at the center of the table.
Or
that's
husband.
Good.
I do have a couple of ladies that game with us.
Glad to hear it.
Absolutely.
So show us what the actual board looked like to remind us.
So
seems to be in fairly good condition.
It is in good condition. I was happy, and it didn't smell like cigarette smoke or cat pee.
Looks a little like Chutes and Ladders.
I forgot how complex that was.
Getting a nice shot there. I'll turn it.
No,
so
that's
you guys
fine.
Can
I appreciate
see.
You showing the camera.
Oh my God, that's crazy. A mess.
Yeah. Yes, this is.
Good Lord.
This is fun to use in D&D.
Are there little things that go?
I can't think of a map. Boom.
Are there little things that go on all those colored squares?
Do you have little, little people?
Yes. There's. Well.
Oh, those are so boring.
No, those are from Sorry.
Yeah.
These are the pawns that TSR used. And, my back has a hole in. That's pretty
good. Didn't have
they actually, later on, as in the 80s, TSR did produce a set of plastic miniatures of a fighter.
I would hope so, because those are boring.
Soul hero, superhero, wizard, elf, that sort of thing. And yes, these are terribly boring, which is why when I play at my house, I break out minis.
Because they didn't want to spend a lot of money on producing this game.
No.
But this particular one I've got here, this is 80 or 81, but this goes all the way back to the early 70s.
And that's where I was going to go with this, is like imagination died somewhere in the mid-90s. So this is back when we could actually see ghouls and goblins and monsters and stuff in those pawns,
right?
Where kids today couldn't possibly see it.
Uh-uh. Right. Now this is
Hold that right close to the lens as you want.
What is that?
This I'm gonna pass this around.
LSD.
Nice. Pass it around. Take one down.
You weren't gonna tell anyone, but
be cool,
I am,
man.
Sorry.
This podcast is gonna be about 7 hours long.
I can only do a half.
Of which six hours won't be recorded.
Yes, go get Todd to put some Pink Floyd on. I think we'll be okay. But this is this particular chit, if you want to check that out. That is a grave marker. When you kill a monster in one of these colored rooms in one of these colored squares, you plot that down so you know that you looted the room once before.
Grave marker,
R.I.P.
It's a grave marker.
I don't think I have old person vision yet, but that is tiny.
Yeah,
it's really, really tiny.
Yeah, that's really, really tiny.
Only because I know what it is,
And then we have, you have spell cards.
That's going to be out of focus.
Yes, it is.
if you play a wizard,
yes,
you can You can cast spells, of course.
So I imagine you thought of this as an incredible... This was an incredible find when you were buying a box of things.
This goes in my dollhouse. Little spell card.
This was so much fireball. Fun. And I was like, oh, okay, fireball, dungeon, fireball. Yeah, that's kind of cool. And I sat down.
Oh, it is fireball.
It is fireball. Fireball, fireball. Oh, and I just pulled that out at random, folks.
This is so rudimentary.
I just
pulled that fireball.
I just pulled that out.
Lightning bolt.
Wow. Explains it all right there.
Are you... Geth protecting? I'm But, yeah, so this game in its box gets some screen time in Stranger Things. I kind of hope we see some more D&D in season 2.
I imagine they will come back in season 2.
I cannot imagine that Wizards of the Coast is unhappy with the exposure. Maybe this will prompt them to do some more old school re-releases.
What I hope doesn't happen is I hope they don't go overboard with it, because the subtlety of the campaign that they were playing in the Dungeons & Dragons linked up pretty well with what they were doing in the show.
And came back around at the end.
They didn't slap you in the face with it.
Right. They never did that with anything 80s about that.
Yeah. And that's what you were talking about, where there was music, but it was selective. Yeah. It was just a tiny little portion of it.
And there was no, let's have a scene where they're all in a video arcade, because arcades were things in the 80s, and kids like to do things in the 80s in the 80s.
The 80s was the set dressing for the show. It wasn't the plot.
Think about how the movie Wedding Singer came out, and I liked it, enjoyed it, it was funny, but they kind of hit you over the head with, this is the 80s, this is the 80s.
Yeah. But that was the funny part of it.
Yeah, that was the funny part of it. But
that works in a comedy, it does not work in a drama or an action adventure. Out.
So the game's in pretty good condition.
This is a good one. If you
there's tape on the corner.
Well, yeah.
If you got to have, the corners are distressed. But if you got to have the one that showed up in Stranger Things, and it's not already a hojillion dollars on eBay, you can expect to pay about $25, $30, maybe $40 for a better condition box.
And I imagine nowhere in existence is one that has never been opened before.
Right.
Did board games come sealed?
Yeah, they were shrink wrapped.
I don't think people did that in the 70s. They didn't keep stuff. They didn't assume that things were going to be worth anything later. So they played with the toys.
Every dungeon that was ever made and bought was opened.
Every once in a while stuff will pop up that's shrink wrapped, and of course,
for my birthday I got two dungeon games. So we put one in the attic and never opened it. All right, go ahead on to the next item.
Okay, so the next stuff we've got, and the big
17 minutes, we're still doing good.
43, okay.
The centerpiece of Stranger Things when you first tune in is the kids are terrified of the Demogorgon. And the dungeon master dramatically
slams
out
there,
a miniature there, and it's the snake armed two ape heads on a kind of a horrific lizard body thing that, and they're, fireball, no, cast protection. That particular miniature, like I said earlier on, was done by Grenadier, who at the time, from the late 1970s to the mid late 1980s, was the signature authorized TSR miniature producer. So when you went to buy official Dungeons & Dragons miniatures, they were done by Grenadier. And along with Dungeon, some Grenadier boxes get some screen time. Now, I'm not sure if these are the exact ones, because it is a blink and you'll miss it.
Right.
Moment.
Just a quick question. Was there a big bootleg scene for miniatures in the 80s?
If there were a lot of miniature producing companies, there were a lot of companies that would sell you whatever minis. Now, like Orc belonged, it doesn't really belong to, it's an old English term, but, any company producing gaming minis would sell you an Orc or Orcs, plural, minis. So, TSR was very much, use our minis. They're the proper scale if you're going to have a miniature combat on the table.
I see.
But really that, as much as I love old D&D and so forth, that's really a bunch of hot air. You put the minis out that look good, that look nice. If Jim didn't bring his mini that night, he's a four-sider. Boom. There's Jim the Wizard is a four-sided
dice. Like minifigs. Either their feet fit in the little holes of Lego, or they don't.
Or they don't.
And if they do, who cares? It's good.
Exactly.
All right.
What do you mean, who cares? What is wrong with you?
So Grenadier was producing these gorgeous miniature boxed sets back in the 80s. And this particular one
Early 80s? You have like a copyright on those
early
as well?
Early 80s. I think these are 79 or 80.
Okay. Damn.
This particular set that I've got.
Good condition.
These are getting more expensive on eBay. One of these will set you back about 40 or 50 bucks.
Okay.
These prices are ridiculous, by the way. I would assume that they are way more than you're saying.
Agreed.
This particular set that I've got here, this is the Wizard's Room, and this is...
Now, do people paint these?
Yes.
Or, okay.
I do.
Because what I'm seeing in there, they don't look painted.
These are not...
Those are naked...
Those are naked, naked minis, so can minis, we get this on YouTube? Will we get red flagged for this?
Well, adult content.
But, yeah. Just check those out there.
Very good.
This is a nice little set.
Is that foam that they're in?
That is. That's foam padding, nice. So they don't beat each other to death.
Is that 1970, 80 foam?
Or did you redo that?
No, wow. No. Okay. I didn't
original
that.
Foam. That's, all right.
It's full of asbestos.
It's true. It's true, everybody. That stuff never deteriorates.
It's all asbestos.
For your protection.
It's all asbestos.
It's all.
It will
fire
be in
retardant.
It's in the landfills forever.
You know, you kid about that, but these... These are lead. These
oh,
are
really no!
These are not, these
don't
are not
eat
pewter.
Those.
These are not white. But it's so
tasty.
Delicious.
Just put it in your mouth.
And there's delicious. A reason that I have these primed but not painted. Lead will oxidize.
Sure, it will.
Lead rot. Is
oh yeah.
A, lead rot is a real thing.
Oh yeah. And you lose all the detail in the figures.
Yep, it'll crumble off. There are people I'm sure who have these boxed up and are like, well, one day I'll paint my old minis from when I was a kid.
Oh yeah, and they take them out of the thing and they fall apart.
And it goes back to what I said before. These are fishing sinkers and that's it.
Yep.
So you throw a little paint on a little primer on to stop the oxidation. You can even just put like clear nail polish. Yep. Anything that keeps the O2 away. This is another one. This is a gaggle of orcs.
A gaggle of orcs.
That, by the way, is a Monster Manual term that's official.
That gaggle. Makes sense.
So, but
a
no,
gaggle of orcs is in the room.
Yes. You enter the room, there's a gaggle of orcs. And to show you how perfectly safe lead is, you can see that the foam in the box is completely undamaged.
Wow.
And I am going to be dead by the end of this podcast.
Wow.
But now they did come sometimes with a painting guide insert, and this particular
one. Oh, so they kind of expected you to paint them.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. And that particular one. And the last one that I've got here.
There's no more in there.
Again, you see three. Shut up. You see three mini boxes on screen, a large one and the two small ones. And this is the large one I've got.
What's in the large one? Looks like a dragon in there. I hope there's a dragon in there.
You are disappointed because
what?
The dragon is put together at
it's
home
on, the goddamn
on my
box.
Shelf. The dragon is put home on is put together at home on my shelf. I didn't want to bring her.
Okay. So it was included. It's just not.
I think I got the last intact one of these ever in existence. We were talking about stuff that gets open.
Yeah.
I picked this up on eBay and I was so happy to get this. And there's a story behind it, which I will tell real quick. Before I ever started playing D&D, I saw this bad boy on the shelf at Zaire's. Remember Zaire's?
Right. Zaire's and Service Merchandise that were competing.
Yes. And I saw this. And one of the reasons Zaire's went away was because they couldn't control their shoplifting, both internally or externally.
Well, you know.
So the next time we went to Zaire's, and I lied to my parents and went to the toy department not to look at Commodore 64 games, I went back.
What kind of a lie is that? Okay, Mom, I'm gonna go see the video games.
Actually, I'm secretly going to see the minis. The mini figs for Dungeons and Dragons.
I was 10. It was a big deal to me. So I went back, and there was the Red Dragon, but the shrink wrap was off.
Oh.
And so I opened the box.
You stole it.
And in the box, not quite.
Okay.
In the box, of course, we have the instruction sheet.
That
for
is badass.
Assembling.
For painting or?
For painting and assembling.
Okay.
And we have the treasure pile here.
Oh, look at that. Okay.
Now, this actually,
the
you
booty.
Can, you can use that as a base. You can mount the dragon right on it. I have it on a separate base at home. But the thing that made me want to buy that more than anything in the world was the bling.
The bling?
It came with an actual set of glass gems to glue
what?
Onto the
wow.
base.
Wow.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And you chose not to.
And I ended up not getting it. I think I bought a couple of D&D modules instead because I thought, well, you know, the dragon is just one dragon.
Yeah.
The modules are adventures that I can run people through. And I regretted it ever since. And then I saw this on eBay a few years ago. And I was like, well, it's probably missing a wing or the head. It's complete. bid,
down the last minute.
I threw down some money. I got this one for $30. If you find one intact, I can't imagine what this would cost.
Could you box that back up? I'd like to see that if you could hand that
absolutely.
Around. Absolutely.
It's going to go around. Everybody feel free.
Yes, yes.
I will hand them all around if you like.
Yeah, just kind of take a look. So the dragon is at home.
The dragon is at home.
In pretty
primed.
Good condition.
Prime. He's in good condition. Now, when I got it, somebody had started to paint it.
Right.
And
They
gave up halfway. But it was too...
Lead poisoning.
Yeah.
It was
they
too
died.
The specifications.
I'm okay with
that. You're very close on the lead poisoning because... Whoa. Well, I got a big tub.
What?
Anybody worth their salt who paints knows that the way you clean up paint off a miniature is simple green.
Mm-hmm. Green.
So I threw the mini into like a big tub of simple green to get the red and yellow paint off of it, and it just floated right off.
Oh.
In full, like complete sheets of paint, shaped like a dragon, floating in the simple green are these hunks of paint.
Okay, wow.
And so I was very happy about that. And I'm talking to some fellows who do historical wargaming about this great find that I had, and one of the guys says, oh yeah, well if that was painted up with the old grenadier and I don't even remember what line of paints he said, be careful, some of that stuff used cadmium in the paint. So I'm sitting there
cadmium?
Holding
that sounds dangerous.
It's a heavy metal.
It's an element.
Yes, cadmium is bad for you.
Yes.
Yes.
Such
bad.
As like mercury might be bad for you.
Yeah, pretty much. So I was actually smarter before I started collecting old D&D miniatures.
And no bullshit, these are lead. They're heavy.
Yeah, they are.
They are heavy.
So yeah,
heavy
I rinsed the I rinsed them thoroughly and then immediately sealed them up.
Mm-hmm.
behind some primer. But yeah, so I had a miniature made out of about 97% lead, covered in paint, full of cadmium.
Oh jeez. Turned out fine.
The safest thing for me to have done at that point would have been to have just pushed everything into the sink and taken a swig of simple green.
So what you're saying is wash my hands before I have another cider.
Oh.
Right.
Oh, yeah. We did touch those things. Damn.
Well,
yes,
heavy.
We
that
did.
Really
don't
is heavy.
Bite your nails.
Washing is kind of a broad term. If you want to include boiling and disinfecting.
Oh,
great.
No, no. These, you know, I'm kidding a lot, but no. These are the ones that are not sealed are there's no oxidation on them or anything.
Just
like
lead.
That.
Ha ha ha.
It's just lead.
So yeah. As far as you
know,
might
not be so goodly smart as you might thought.
Goodly smart with wording with words.
Maybe I'm not fertile anymore. Yes.
As far as you know.
Wow.
Well, there's one way to find out. As far as you know, you can find all these items on eBay.
You can find, yes, you can find
some are more rare than
items
others.
On eBay. Right. Don't go fishing for a Demogorgon because it's going to cost
don't
you.
Don't go fishing for a Demogorgon.
Right, yes. Right.
Nice 20-year-old reference.
I know, as we talk about
that is,
40
that is the
references.
Youngest thing that we have talked about
yeah,
at the table.
Yeah,
we are old farts.
Yes. Huh? Cut us in half and count our rings.
So from the female perspective, Beth. These are items that you find some interest in, that you appreciate the history in these items.
All right, so when you say from the female perspective.
Because we don't usually have them here at this table.
Oh, my God, I don't usually play Dungeons & Dragons because I just menstruate all over it. It's terrible.
Ew, gross.
That was in the original script for Stranger Things, but they took it out.
Yeah.
Sorry, Al. Yeah, word for word. It's just that I'm happy to see somebody who has an appreciation for these things that is female, because we don't get a lot of that here at this table on the show.
Queen doesn't come here
at
anymore.
This store. I know.
No, I mean, I've played Dungeons & Dragons, to be honest. I played it for about 18 months, and then our dungeon master was like, my girlfriend doesn't want me to play anymore.
Oh.
What the hell?
I would have kept playing.
My wife and kids play
with
me.
Get a new girlfriend.
Did you ever play as dungeon master?
No. I was new to it.
I never did either. Yeah, I was always on the other side of it.
I got hoodwinked into playing healer, and I've been pissed about it ever
healer?
Since.
Healer?
Yes. I wanted to be a tank.
Wait, clerics are awesome, though.
Are you just,
I don't
they're
know.
Great. Are you pig fighters?
Are you pigeonholed into healer
cleric,
as forever?
Cleric,
no, it's
cleric,
kind of a thing.
Cleric.
You ask about, for a woman perspective, it's stereotypical for a woman to play a healer.
I see.
Fuck
and
that.
They,
why can't you be an orc? Why can't you be a...
Well, I was coming from an RPG, and I didn't know that cleric meant healer. And I was like, cleric sounds cool, whatever. And then I was duped into it.
Here, put this outfit on.
I'm not going to addition more too much, but there's there is a lot to be said for the old school cleric. They're pretty much martial, mm-hmm. people. They're up there holding up holy symbols, destroying undead, being very good second tier fighters. They can wear plate mail, chain mail, whatever they want. You know, throwing holy water and burning oil on the guys.
You know what? I'll just intervene here. The team that I videotape and it's Miriam over there at Kinky Goth. She is a bard. So it's like, why do women characters have to be these weak?
They don't. And I'm going to tell
you,
you
a song about catching.
Yeah,
animals.
It's pretty much it. Yeah, she's got a song to distract. It's like, what the fuck is that? It's like
my take your top off and do the same.
Yeah, they do that all the time.
Do they really?
Yes, they really do.
My wife's character.
That's so lame.
My wife's character. Get out of here, Zika.
Bug. It's
we
back.
Have this bug. It comes back every
one
few
bug.
Episodes. One
in,
bug.
In the game. In the game that I've had going for about 6 years now. My wife's character.
That is a long game.
She plays a paladin. She refuses to play any kind of spellcaster. She says, she's just like, there's too much thinking. I just want to stab and bash things.
and that's what I'm all about. Just wreck stuff.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, she
photons
is
and phasers
ablazing.
Yeah. She is pretty much a ferocious tank.
Women can be warriors. They should be.
I mean, this may or may not mean a whole lot to you guys, but I threw a demon at a very low level party.
Okay.
It was just one of those things. I rolled some dice and I looked at a chart and I was like, you know what? I'm just going to let those dice tell a story because this is interesting. And, you know, being a paladin, a holy warrior, she waded in. The thing was at negatives to hit her. And the whole party whittled it down, and she was like, yeah, that was great. That was awesome. But I would never, I would never presume to say, well, Colleen, I think you'd be happier as a bard standing in the back singing or maybe, a healer. No, it just that don't go. Mm-hmm.
Well, if I ever start a new campaign, I will be something that just wrecks stuff. Just some sort of savage.
Yes. So I find that... it literally just comes down to the group and the mindset you've got going in. I don't insist on people taking a given role. If it's somebody's first time ever playing D&D, an old school D&D, I'll say you should start just with a fighter, mm-hmm. just because it's the simplest,
it's well-rounded.
Easiest
it's fine.
Thing to
yeah.
do. You don't have to get your head out of
it. You don't have to think too hard.
Yeah. Woman, whatever. Just play a fighter. So you can get the most basic mechanics down pat. Because you're watching, the guy who's been playing for 7 years or 10 years or 30 years, like me, over there, and he's playing a magic user, and you're like, wow, Disintegration. Okay. That sounds really cool. It's not just an album title, it's a spell.
We got a couple minutes left before we go, but I want to ask you, where can people find you online, and what would you think you'd bring next time?
What the hell happened?
I don't know.
Somebody just bought something.
Flame Strike. You can find me on Facebook.
Yes,
Bill Silvey on Facebook.
All right, and something you may bring next time to entice the audience.
Something I may bring next time. I am going to bring the next few original Dungeons and Dragons supplements, and I'm going to bring something that Greg asked about. But no spoilers.
Request. Okay, no spoilers.
Greg
made
had
a request.
Mentioned something. And I'm
I don't even know what I asked for.
Exactly.
Nice.
That's what makes it better.
Nice.
So, once we kind of switch lanes and we leave the era of original Dungeons & Dragons. I'm going to talk about basic Dungeons & Dragons and advanced Dungeons & Dragons.
Okay, and advanced Dungeons. Now, yes. Beth, where can people find you online if they are interested?
They can look up Friendly Cosplay or Friendly Neighborhood Cosplay. I make and wear costumes, but I'm more in the lines of teaching other people how to make and wear costumes other than, you have to pay me for a selfie.
And then the costume you're wearing today from Doctor Who, did you make that yourself?
Oh, I thought she was just a phone booth.
Yes.
No, I didn't make this. I actually brought a costume with me because there's a cosplay meetup, but I didn't know what kind of crowd is going
to
be here. So
yeah,
you'll
have to go
car.
To the back of the room and check. And Greg, where can people find you online and tell us about your YouTube page?
San Dimas, hi!
No!
Oh. I'm on Facebook, but don't look at me there. Good Egg Pro. Actually, I think it's YouTube/Good Egg Productions at this point.
Oh, okay.
I did get my...
you changed the official URL?
Yeah, I got a custom URL.
Customized
now.
URL, because you get a certain amount of subscribers.
YouTube/Good Egg Productions.
I'm still just the Dungeon Delver on YouTube.
The Dungeon
Good
Delver.
For you.
And, of course, you can find us on Gods and Monsters Facebook page. You can go to our YouTube page. You're probably on it right now, but please hit the subscribe button. Because the Gods and Monsters...
YouTube show has less viewers than the Miata YouTube channel.
Hey, people like Miatas.
He's beating us by leaps and bounds now. It's embarrassing. But we won't be here next week. We'll be here the week after, I believe. And then once
and
again, on the 30th,
after that.
We've got wrestling again on September 30th. We want you to come on after that. It's a Friday night. Come down here. Tickets are only $15, and you can sit for $25 in the front
Thank
row.
You spared me having to do that.
That's coming up in just a couple of weeks, so please subscribe, like us, give us your comments on box office predictions for Sully. What's the name of the movie?
Sully.
The
Sully,
Eastwood
it's
movie?
The sequel to Monsters, Inc.
Yes.
I think.
No, yes. No, that's a different thing. If you're going into it for that, you're going to be seriously disappointed. Thank
sure,
you all
make fun of the
for
with one
watching.
Eye.
We'll be back in 2 weeks. Thanks for watching, and thank you guys for visiting with us.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.